Thanks very much, Rick. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your interest in this topic, which we in the Australian Council of Deans of Agriculture and the university sector see as a major issue. And so I've entitled my talk, Professional Agriculture, a Matter of Supply and Demand. Nobody would deny that agriculture is a complex business. In fact, its complexity probably outstrips most other forms of endeavour. And that complexity is on the increase, as is the expectation that the sector will be self-serving, self-reliant, and a lot of support mechanisms over time. There's also the issue of increased compliance on farmers and other people involved in the sector, and of course variability happens to be a constant in our industry. We're moving towards stringent market standards. We're probably expecting to go down the accreditation line at some point, and of course we've got all the environmental challenges that you wish to know. So, on that basis then, we would expect that the industry has a need for a workforce which is highly educated, highly skilled, and where, as an industry, we would welcome and would really like to attract the best and the brightest. So the question is, how's the industry travelling? And that's where we want to go right now. If we have a look at the level of education of our industry, then we find that over the period of the last 25 years, there has been an increase in the proportion of people who have tertiary education. But if we have a look at the numbers and relate it to the rest of the community, we're actually not very competitive at all. We moved from something like about 3% in 1984 to about 7 or 8% in 2009 of our people with tertiary qualifications in one of the most complex industries in Australia. And yet the community has moved well ahead of us to something like about 26% of the community having tertiary qualifications. And you can see that that gap is actually widening rather than narrowing over time. If we turn those data around, we actually find that we're leading. We're leading in terms of no post-school qualifications. So that's not something that I think we ought to be proud of. It happens to be a fact that even in 2009, we had double the proportion of people with no qualifications post-school compared to the rest of the community. And you'd have to ask yourself, is that good enough for an industry of our complexity, of our importance to the Australian community, potentially to the global community in terms of food security? Now, one of the reasons we embarked on having a look at this whole issue was the fact that in 2007, the government policy settings said that there were plenty of graduates in agriculture, the official policy I'm talking about, but there were no jobs. And in fact, the industry outlook was bleak, and it was described by some of the modellers as a sunset industry. Now, the Council of Deans of Agriculture, newly formed at that point, found that hard to digest because all the information experience being received at the universities was the opposite of that. And so concerns were that maybe the basis on which those policies were made were perhaps flawed. The rationale for the policy, and the rationale was easily explained, in terms of the graduate supply data, When the minister asked for that information, he was provided with the data of all the graduates in the agriculture cluster, the agriculture cluster being the level of funding that the university received for that type of course. So all the environmental science graduates also spewed out, as did pathology graduates and a few others. And so the data that he got was about 3 or 4 times higher than what was actually the case in terms of graduates. In terms of the job situation, discussions with the Department of Employment at that time indicated no jobs. And when asked how they determined that information, it was explained that they based it on the number of advertisements in the Sydney Morning Herald and The Age on Mondays and Wednesdays. And then that was multiplied by a factor based on their experience, none of which was in agriculture. So that was the policy position, and that's how it was determined. If we have a look at the data, the real data, then from the period 2001 to 2008, I'm sorry I don't have 2009-10, but there are a couple of universities got caught up in a flood, and so their computer systems were not conducive to dragging out the information. So I apologise on their behalf. So we've got to satisfy ourselves with 2008 as the end point. But this is university degrees in agriculture and agricultural science. And so you can see that it's dropped from just over 500 to just under 400 in the 8 years, a drop of 20%. And that trend is likely to continue. We can fudge the numbers a little bit by adding related courses. And so you can see that the graph that I've just shown you is that line there. And then we can add horticulture and viticulture, which of course would be mainly viticulture, because horticulture is almost extinct species in university education in Australia now. Agricultural economics, agricultural business, and animal science. Now, most universities want extra students put on a course in animal science. Unfortunately, most of it's got nothing to do with the livestock industries, and so we have to discount the animal science numbers by probably 2/3. And so that means that we get a number around about 800 or so as the greater supply of agriculture and related students from that might be of value to our industry.